Tonight, in the third of ITV's major interviews with the party leaders, this week talks to the Prime Minister and leader of the Conservative Party, Margaret Thatcher, about her record and her proposals for Britain over the next 5 years. Prime Minister, at the start of your campaign, you said you wanted to go on and on and on. Is that because you think that in order to achieve your goals, as your campaign slogan suggests, that you need another 10 years?
I hope the Conservative Party will go on and on and on in government, obviously, because I believe in what we're doing. For me, I have to tackle this campaign, and I hope with the team to win it. But you know, I was under quite heavy questioning at the time, and the objective of the questioning was to try to discover whether sometime in mid-term I might give up.
Might you?
Of course I said, I really would like to go on.
Do you share Prime Minister Lord Young's assessment that unemployment will continue to fall at between 20,000 and 25,000 a month?
We expect it to continue to fall at about the same rate as it is now. But of course one never knows about things like a world recession. One never knows whether you're going to get some protectionism put on by one country. One never knows quite what may happen, which might affect oil prices. And so everything is subject to that. But we do hope and expect and believe that it will continue to fall.
He said you could work out where that might get you, and he was referring to the Alliance's claim that they would reduce the unemployment figures by 1 million over 3 years. And indeed, if it were to get you there at your rate, it would be 900,000 over 3 years. Is that what you're expecting?
Well, I think one has to keep one thing absolutely clear. You can create quite a lot of extra jobs, but it doesn't always reduce the unemployment register by that much. First, because the population of working age is going up. And secondly, because quite a lot of the extra jobs are taken by married women. And therefore, it's very unwise to predict the precise unemployment register.
But why don't you forecast generally? Other economic indicators are forecast, inflation, trade, and so on.
Inflation we have a very much more better idea of for about 2 months or 3 months in advance. Trade is a little bit uncertain, as you know. The Chancellor actually forecast a deficit for this year of 2.2 billion. Actually, in the first 4 months, we've had a surplus, which is a very, very good thing. But I think if you look at employment for a moment, you can see why. Most of the jobs are created by business. Jobs come from successful business. You don't quite know what the course of many, many businesses will be. You do know that if we get growth, the likelihood is that unemployment will fall. We have had growth for a number of years, and unemployment is at last beginning to fall, and we expect it to go on falling. But there are so many uncertainties that I would not like to put a precise figure on it.
Should the voter discount those independent economic institutions that have said that on present policies, they forecast that by the end of the next term, with your policies, unemployment would still hover around 3 million.
I have seen so many forecasts during my life, and things happen which falsify them. And I would not like to say that. Indeed, I wouldn't say that, because I think perhaps they're not taking into account that early 1990s, there's one fundamental factor in the situation which is different. As you know, in the last 10 years, we've had far more school leavers than we've had people retiring. That's just the way the birth rate went many, many years ago. So year after year after year, we've had more school leavers, which means we've got about 1 million more people in the population of working age. That position reverses early 1990s, far fewer school leavers, far many more people retiring. Now, that undoubtedly will be quite a big factor, but you've got to reckon that they'll have to be trained, those school leavers, because there are far many more jobs for trained people now and far fewer jobs for comparatively unskilled people.
If the unemployment figures were still around 3 million or so by the end of the next term and you were Prime Minister, would you think it fair that it should be applied to you, what you applied to James Callaghan when he was Prime Minister and the unemployment figures were only 1.5 million, that he would go down in history as the Prime Minister of Unemployment?
I think a great deal depends upon what happens to the world economy, and as you know, we're having the Venice Economic Summit. We're doing our level best not to get protectionism, and we are one of the countries that doesn't want protectionism. It means sometimes that we keep our borders open to trade when others don't. A great deal depends upon that, but I think if we get steady growth of the kind we are getting, we shall in fact get unemployment falling. How far new technology will reduce the number of jobs and how far it will mean that we can produce things we've never produced before is difficult to judge.
In the present circumstances, do you think that those 2 million or so pensioners who rely on the basic state pension have enough to live a decent life?
But they don't have to rely on the basic state pension.
With supplementary pension as well. That's precisely
why we have a supplementary pension, because everyone in effect now has two pensions. They either have the basic plus their occupational
enough to live a decent life.
And those who haven't have the basic plus supplementary benefit, plus housing benefit and rate rebates usually. Obviously, one would always like to give more, and one tries to give just a hint more to those who are older because they have gone on longer. But we guarantee inflation-proof the pension, the basic pension for the old folk, and the related benefits. And one of the related benefits is supplementary benefits, so that also is guaranteed. It's inflation-proofed.
When there was known that I was going to be interviewing you, lots of letters came in here, many of them from pensioners. One of them, if I can quote it to you, says this: I'm 76, one of your older pensioners, and I should be glad if you would ask Mrs. Thatcher what advice she can give me in order to spend the extra 15p she awarded me in the budget to my best advantage. What is your advice to her?
The 15p awarded in the budget.
I think she was probably referring to the April uprating in practice, which in fact gives her, I think, 11p
a day. Well, now look, what we have done, as you know, is to say to the pensioner, we will inflation-proof your basic pension. Now, what happens when inflation is low, 4%? Obviously, it's inflation-proof to the extent of 4%. But, you know, 4% means that the pension does not lose its value very quickly. Now, in days during the Labour Party, when it was in government, it got right up to 27%. So, yes, they got a 27% increase. Well, not always, because Barbara Castle changed the basis of calculation. But then it lost its value very, very quickly. Now, some of them still think of the increase in actual money terms rather than relating it to the rate of inflation.
So is your advice to her, which it seems to be, rejoice and be merry?
No, I don't think you're quite being fair, Mr. Dimbleby. I did not say that. I said what we have done is to guarantee that we would inflation-proof the basic pension, and we've been able to do that, not only with the number of pensioners that were there when we started, but with 1 million more pensions, 1 million more pensioners. And it's not guaranteed so much by government. It is the ordinary working population, because the money paid out in pensions this year is the money paid in national insurance contributions by the working population. And if they only have the basic pension, then they will get a supplementary benefit, also inflation-proof. They also will get housing benefit, which meets their rent. They will also get rate rebate. And also, may I point out, that when
Would you accept poverty? Please, there's just one other thing.
When we get bad weather, the Labour Party only gave £90 million a year on heating allowances. With us, it's up over £400 million. And that, too, is important. And we've been able to do these things because under Conservative government, we've had strong growth and a strong economy. Without that, we'd not be able to do them. Of course, one would always like to do more. But fortunately now, most people are retiring with two pensions, the basic and an occupational pension. A large number have savings. 71% of pensioners who retire have savings. A half of them have their own homes. And, of course, more and more will have shares.
For those who don't, what do you think it says about our society that when you get the weather going down to zero or so, we have to suddenly find fivers to avert the risk that some old-age pensioners don't die of hypothermia? What does that say about our society? Not comparisons with what Labour did or didn't do, but just what it says about us now.
But it's a great deal more than a fiver, because you haven't taken into account the amount that's in supplementary benefit.
The extra amount that they had, I'm talking
about. For severe weather payments. What does it say about our society? It says about our society that they are willing to find the money and make it available. You know, there used not to be these payments. In Harold Macmillan's time, there was no such thing. No such thing at all. In Harold Macmillan's time, there was no such thing as housing benefit either.
Can I move on to tax? You've been very clear in stating that you want the tax rate, basic rate, to go down to 25p and maybe lower if growth will allow it. Can you be more specific about what you have in mind for VAT? I know that you ruled out VAT on food. Do you rule out VAT on, for instance, children's clothes, books, newspapers, fuel,
fares,
water?
If anyone tried to put value-added tax on children's clothes and shoes, they would never, never, never get it through the House.
So that's
Tony Barber, I remember very vividly the debates. Tony Barber, in fact, eliminated it on those things. Now, I have said that we get this every single election. I have said, no, it's zero rate on food and also on gas and electricity. The other thing just would never go through that you particularly mentioned. Now, I'm not going any further than that, Mr. Dillon, for a very good reason. Yes, people like you will try to go on, and the moment we say one thing, you'll find another, and then another.
Well,
one moment.
The viewer might be interested, Prime Minister.
And then another. But you see, a Chancellor of the Exchequer has to govern according to the circumstances, and no responsible minister would constrain him. No responsible minister.
The one you didn't mention
yes,
in was books and magazines.
Things.
Does that mean that they're the ones
you're
that
going
might
to try? No, you're going. Yes, and that's exactly a typical question.
I'm sorry.
Yes, but you.
But
simply,
people might be interested, Prime Minister, in this.
Well, let me say to people, I have undertaken not to do it on food. That was in right from the beginning, and on gas and electricity. No, we haven't got any particular plans to do it on other things, but I'm not going to constrain a Chancellor of the Exchequer. I don't know what the circumstances will be of any particular budget. I know that when he comes and looks at it at the time, he's got to look at income tax, value-added tax, customs and excise duties, national insurance contributions, and he's got to look right across the field.
But if you don't rule things out, aren't some people going to say, Prime Minister, that's their hidden manifesto?
Yes, they are. But then I'm going to say to them, look at our record. Look at our record. Look at our expenditure record. We have spent extra money when we've had the growth to do so. And if you are in fact talking about VAT or income tax, please look at the Labour Party. You simply cannot. No, don't stop me.
I didn't stop you, Prime Minister.
Just like that. You simply cannot say you're going to spend $35 billion, and it seems to be added to every day, without putting a colossal amount on VAT, a colossal amount on income tax. Let me stand on our record. We have run the affairs of this country, the financial affairs, soundly. We haven't overborrowed. When we've spent more than we thought actually we wanted to spend, but nevertheless we had to spend it, we've financed it soundly. Sometimes by higher income tax than we would wish, sometimes by putting up other taxes higher than we wish, but it's financed soundly, and everyone knows now there'll be no financial crisis under a Conservative government. That's something worth knowing.
Your manifesto points out that someone on average earnings is now paying something like £500 a week less in tax.
£500 a year.
Sorry, I beg your pardon, £500 a year
less in
tax.
£10 a week less in tax.
What it doesn't point out is that that same person is paying something like £250 a year more in national insurance contributions and £250 a year more in indirect taxes, principally VAT. Relatively speaking, therefore, someone on average earnings is actually paying back just about the same proportion of their earnings as they did in 1979.
His take-home pay is considerably up. Considerably
up. In 1979, Prime Minister, you said that you thought that the amount the state took was too high, but it's the same, isn't it, for the man on average earnings?
His take-home pay is considerably up. Yes, his national insurance contributions have gone up. And you simply cannot ask me why we do not increase the basic pension, particularly for the older folk, and then say, but you must cut down your national insurance contributions. Mr. Dimbleby, it doesn't make sense. What goes out this year in pensions comes in this year in national insurance contributions. It's the taxpayer, or, to be more accurate, the person who pays in national insurance contributions that provides the pension this year. You're now castigating me for two opposite things. Firstly, for not trying to provide more for the pensioner, and we do inflation-proof it and try to provide as much as we can, and at the same time castigating me then for having actually made that provision possible from the working population. Yes, every time I face the opposition, Tuesday and Thursday on questions, and I see more expenditure, more, as if it were just confetti money, I do say, look, you don't pay it. nor does government, except as citizens. All of this has to come out of the population of working age, either in their tax for supplementary benefit and housing benefit, or in their national insurance contributions for pensions and sickness benefit, invalidity benefit, unemployment benefit, and so on.
Could I move on? This morning you explained why, at a press conference, why you don't use the National Health Service. And you explain, and I'm sure many people understand, that as Prime Minister you have to be able to get into hospital when you can, because you've got other duties, as you might say. But you also went on to say, which I want to ask you about, I exercise my right as a free citizen to spend my own money in my own way. Now, without saying anything about that right, which of course you have, do you acknowledge that the great majority of your fellow citizens do not have the freedom to exercise that right because they don't have the money to do it?
I do exercise the right to choose how I spend my money. Some would spend it on other things. Some would spend it on alcohol, some spend it on cigarettes, some would spend it on gambling, some would spend it on many, many other things.
But the viewer at home, who knows they can't afford it, are going to say, Prime Minister, I'm not wasting my money on gambling and cigarettes. I simply can't afford private health.
Mr. Dimbleby, I think what you are saying is if everyone can't have it, no one shall have it. If you take that view, there'll be no progress at all. Let me give you an example. When we came back into office a long time ago, 1951, only 30% of people owned their own homes. Had we adopted your argument, Mr. Dimble, it would have said, if everyone can't have it, no one should have it. That's the socialist, it's the communist argument. If everyone can't have it, no one shall have it. And therefore, let's take it away, let's make them all council tenants. No, we didn't. We did a real Tory thing. We said, let's try to bring to more and more people what only a few have now. And so, now there's 65% in England who own their own homes. Now, the average earnings are going up. The standard of living of the people is going up.
So you expect the proportion in the National Health Service to shift across the private sector in the same way?
As a matter of fact, the number of people who are choosing to insure, and they choose. And if they don't want to, we're all paying our dues to the National Health Service. The average family of four in this country pays to the National Health Service every week in the several taxes, £27. £27. And if they choose, having paid that in their taxes, if they choose to spend their money in a way which gives them private insurance or private housing or better clothes or a better car, Mr. Dimbleby, fortunately, we have a free society, and our view is to enlarge the choice of people and not to reduce it.
You said if they want to spend more for better this, better that, better so-and-so. If the National
Health...
You were saying better, but I'll accept different,
of
course.
A private house is different from a council house.
If I can relate that to the National Health Service, if I may, if the National Health Service is only safe in your hands, wouldn't it be a good idea to demonstrate that? And the way of demonstrating that might be to use it, some people would say.
Don't you think that you'd have got at me very much had I said, look, I've got to be in on a certain day, and I've got to be out on a certain day. You'd accuse me of queue jumping, and you'd have been the first to have done so.
Certainly
and
not.
If you're getting 5 million people doing that as well, don't you think you're going to put an extra burden? Don't you think you're going to make the waiting list longer? And that even so, Mr. Dimbleby, that the day I walked into Downing Street, the economy was such that the taxpayer could only afford to pay £8 billion a year to the National Health Service. After 8 years of Tory government, the economy is such that the taxpayer can now afford to pay £21 billion to the health service. Now, from 8 to £21 billion is an enormous increase. It's come about because we run the economy successfully. It's come about because people have a higher standard of living. If some of them choose, and 5 million do, and some trade unions negotiate it with employers to spend their money in that way, they are free to do so. Thank goodness they are still free to do so.
Do you think it is any comfort to those 750,000 or so who are on hospital waiting lists to know that this money has been spent? What comfort can that be to them when they look forward to the prospect of months and maybe years waiting for operations, worried, anxious, and even in pain?
750,000 people on waiting lists. There are 70,000 more people on waiting lists in 1979.
Is that a comfort to those who are on it now?
No, I'm sure it isn't. I'm sure it isn't, because if I wanted a hip operation or a cataract, of course. But over and above what happened in 1979, there's a great deal more spent, as I indicated, from 7, nearly 8 billion to 21. There are more doctors, there are more nurses. Equally, Mr. Dimbleby, there are a lot more treatments. There are a lot more operations available to everyone. You get a new treatment, you get a new waiting list. When Alec Merrison did an investigation into the health service, a commission on the health service, he said, we had no difficulty in believing that the whole national income could be spent on the health service. Well, of course it can't. But this government, no, let me stand up for my own government. This government has spent far more, the taxpayers spent far more, because the economy is strong. More doctors, more nurses. We've just allocated another 50 million to try to get those waiting lists down. I most earnestly hope they will come down. But believe you me, it wouldn't help them to come down if 5 million people said we're going to give up insurance and all come onto the National Health Service.
I would like to ask you lots more. I would like to ask you lots more on that topic, but I want to move on to education, for which you've made many radical proposals. Can I ask you generally first, how long do you think it will be before the state sector is good enough so that more of your colleagues, your cabinet ministers, take the choice to educate their offspring in the state system rather than exercising their choice to educate them outside that system?
In many cases, it is. I revisited my own old school a few months ago. The education that they're having is absolutely marvellous, even better than we had, because frankly the facilities are better, the laboratories are better, the domestic science is better, the art is better, the mathematics, the physics, everything. It is fantastic.
Why don't more of your colleagues then
But quite a number do.
Cabinet ministers sending their children to secondary schools in state systems.
And some of them are very fortunate in that they live in areas where there are very good state schools, because, as you know, the kind of school you get and the standard you get often varies very much from one part of the country to another. And there are many, many excellent schools. I would say the majority of schools in the state sector are very good. In inner cities, some of them are very, very far from that. Now, people pay, in taxation and rates, for the education that they're getting. In some inner cities, it's take it or leave it. And some of the parents don't want that kind of education, and they're trapped. And that is why we said, right, we will try to release you from those local authorities so you can have exactly the same money from ratepayer and taxpayer as they will get there, and set up a trust, and you can run a different kind of school, run directly under the Department of Education and Science. It is an extra choice. It's so that people, do you know, some people make fantastic sacrifices to try to get their children out of some of those schools. Frankly, I agree with you, they ought not to have to. The amount they pay in rates and taxes, they should be able to have more choice than they have at the moment.
Would you like to see a situation in which those schools that opt out, the comprehensive schools, that over a period of time, given your great enthusiasm for the grammar school system, that a great number of those comprehensive decide to take up the grammar school option? Is that what you, if you were a parent, there would be
urging? That is not the only way you can get a grammar school. You can have a local education authority putting up a proposal for a grammar school.
Would you like to see more generally, then, can I ask
you? I think in inner cities, I think the grammar school was the ladder from the bottom, however far one wished to climb, for many a young person that would never have had it. There were some very, very famous grammar schools, which really were direct ones.
Would you like to see more, generally? I personally
would like to see more, because if you look at the House of Commons, many of us who got there through a grammar school system.
Prime Minister, let's move on again to defence, if I may.
Do you remember Harold Wilson? Perhaps you don't, you're too young. Do you remember Harold Wilson saying grammar schools will be abolished over his dead body?
I do remember that, but I don't think we have time to pursue that
now. What a pity. That was the view of many Labour people in those days.
You've made it very clear that you believe that the only way a small country like ours can protect itself against nuclear blackmail is by the possession of the nuclear weapon as the ultimate deterrent. Would you therefore regard it as a right of other small countries who regard themselves in that same predicament to exercise that same right to acquire nuclear weapons?
No, I happen to believe in the non-proliferation agreement.
But wouldn't it be that they should have the right to do it as well? I'm not talking about the logic.
I'm talking about Britain's history. I'm talking about the fact that Britain hung on when the rest of Europe surrendered. I'm talking about the fact that Britain was right in the beginning of the atomic weapon, that many of our scientists who'd done a great deal of work here went over to the States to complete it. Britain has been an atomic power right from the beginning, and I sometimes tremble to think what would have happened had Hitler got that weapon first. We wouldn't be here talking now. So don't take it only on a question of logic. Take it on a question of Britain's history, Britain's unique position, the fact that Europe would not now be free unless Britain had hung on until the United States came in, and we are both atomic powers and must continue to be so.
You are fiercely in opposition to the Labour Party's policy on this. Do you, however, and I don't want to go into that, if you will allow me not to lead you into that, do you, though, regard Neil Kinnock as much as a patriot as you are?
I do not comment on what my leaders of the opposition or leaders of the other party believe. I believe passionately that the nuclear weapon has kept peace for 40 years.
You can't say whether you believe he is a passionate or not.
I believe passionately.
You can't say whether you believe that Neil Kinnock is a patriot or not.
I am not discussing him. I am here to answer the questions for me. I don't discuss the leader of the opposition. I discuss his policies. That nuclear weapon has kept the peace for 40 years. There is no way in which I would put our young people, and if a war starts, it's the young who bear the brunt of it, in the field without the same protection as those whom one day they may face. No way. It would be totally letting them down. It would be totally getting rid of the thing which has kept peace. And peace matters to me, a peace with freedom and justice.
Very briefly, Prime Minister, if you were to lose your overall majority, would that be the time at which you would say, I will depart the office of Prime Minister?
No, not necessarily. It is possible not to have a total majority, but to carry on, because you are by far the largest party. I don't expect to lose our overall majority. I hope and believe we shall be returned with it.
Prime Minister, thank you very much.